Good morning, everyone. If you haven't finished your tea or coffee, don't worry. Maybe you can sing through it. A few announcements, so that will give you a wee bit more time to finish your tea and coffee. Quite a few announcements, so if you could just bear with me as I quickly go through them. As far as our own church family is concerned, during the week we have bowls at 7:30 on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday we have Cameo. That is at 12:30. And if you could just, on your way out, if you want, just let me know if you're planning to come to that, so we have an idea of how many we're catering for. That's Cameo on Wednesday at 12:30. Then Wednesday evening, 7 o'clock, the choir will be practicing in the church hall, followed by our midweek fellowship at 8 o'clock. Then next Sunday evening is the community carol service at 7 p.m. and that will be held in Christ Church, so that's Kilmore Parish, and we trust you'll be able to join us for that. That's next Sunday evening at 7 p.m. And then just to give you a heads up on what's happening as far as Christmas services in our own congregation here, on Sunday the 18th, that will be our nativity service, whenever the young people will be taking part in that. That'll be 11:30 on Sunday the 18th. And then in the evening of the 18th, we will be having our carol service, carols by candlelight. And then Christmas being on a Sunday this year, we will be having a normal service, but earlier. So we'll be having our Christmas morning service at 10 o'clock. But it would be a normal service. It'll be a family service, but that will be at 10 o'clock on Christmas morning. And then when you come in, you may have already received your offering envelopes. We'll call them offering envelopes because there are three within the box. There's the ordinary free will offering, then you have your mission one, and then the harvest envelope is also in there. They're all different colours, so you'll be able to work them out. But the free will offering comes first, then the mission, and then the very back will be the harvest. So if you have not collected them as you come in, you can collect them the way out. Those of you who give by direct debit or transfer will have received just an envelope which has your harvest and whatever else is in there. I haven't opened it yet. But so if you can take those, please. And then just finally, if you didn't have the opportunity to give to the Presbyterian Children's Society, there are still some envelopes in the vestibule from the little table just behind the main door. If you have brought your envelopes back today, thank you very much. But you can bring them, if you didn't have the opportunity to do today, you can still bring them next week. I think those are all the announcements as I have them. In Psalm 113, we read these words. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth? Praise the Lord. We're going to do that together as we stand to sing our first song, which is entitled Light of the World.
Beauty that made this heart adore you. Oh.
Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Father God, we are here to worship, to bow down, and to recognize who you are. There is no one like you. You're altogether lovely. You're altogether powerful. You're altogether gracious. And Lord, as we contemplate what you have done for us in Christ Jesus, it does make us humble because we are indebted to you. Indebted to you for all the things that we enjoy every day, all the blessings that come our way. We don't deserve those blessings, but you do shower them upon us. And we are so thankful that you do. Because without you, we are nothing. Without you, we are lost. But as we come to you, Lord God, through Jesus Christ, we can come right into the very presence of a holy and righteous God. Not because we are worthy, but because Jesus Christ is worthy. And he assists us. He walks us into your presence. We can only do that whenever we have him as our friend, our Savior, our Lord. We are thankful that he has forgiven us when we confess our sins, and he is there to say, not guilty. So we pray that as we gather in this place, we will be mindful that in Christ we are new creatures. In Christ we become children of the living God. In Christ, we are freed from slavery to ourselves and slavery to sin. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you did that whenever you came and you lived and you died and you rose again. So in this Advent season, we do thank you for your coming into the world, giving up all the glory in heaven and living on earth. And despite all your love and your compassion and your words of truth, people neglected you and rejected you. And Lord, if we had been there, we probably would have done exactly the same. So we come and we say, thank you that despite our sin, you have loved us with an everlasting love. So, Holy Spirit, come into our midst afresh. We will know that you are here because you are inspiring us in our worship. You are leading us into truth, and you're guiding in the paths of God, the paths of righteousness, and all for the sake of the name of Jesus Christ. So accept our worship, our praise, our prayers. Enthuse us to read and to obey the word of God. So, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, this is the worship we bring. And we do so through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. And so we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, boys and girls, I think you will probably recognize this picture. What is it? It's a Christmas tree. Well done, Alfie. Yes, Christmas tree. And, well, how many have got your tree up? Well done. Good, good. Did you help to put it up?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Well, as you can see, we have ours here lit and nicely decorated. I'm afraid I haven't got round to doing it yet. We usually leave it until maybe next week because in the manse with underfloor heating, we always like to have a real one, so it'll last a wee bit longer, or at least last to the new year. We will get it there. But a tree like that is not really what you say most exciting. It's a tree, and if it's out in a wood or a forest, it's wonderful. But whenever you bring it into the house and just put it there, I'm not sure how many people would come in and say, "Why, isn't that beautiful?" So what do you need to put on it? Yes.
Decorations.
And what's the first thing? I know people have different ways of doing it. The first thing that I do is this, put the lights on. Otherwise, it can be an absolute disaster. So put the lights on, and that will brighten up the tree, and it will make it look good. But what else do you put on it? Bubbles, yes. There you are, some bubbles. Now, the bubbles that I like are the ones that are really, really shiny. And you can see the ones that I've chosen to put in the picture. The red and the goldy coloured ones. Why do you think I would like those? Why do you think I would like those? They're sparkly, yes, Alfie. They are sparkly. And the reason that they're sparkly is that the lights shine on them and they reflect the light, that they make the light even brighter because they're hanging beside. And if you look at the ones on our own tree here, the ones that are really, really shiny are the ones that are giving out a lot of light, or it seems as if they're giving out the light, but they're not the lights, they're just reflecting the lights. And as I thought about those baubles, I thought of us. How does that figure out? Well, you see, whenever we give our lives to the Lord Jesus, we become like the bauble in that we reflect Jesus to others. They can, I hope, see Jesus living in us. He is the light of the world. We were singing about that in our first song. And because he's the light of the world, he wants other people to know about him. And if we belong to Jesus, then we are like the baubles, that we reflect the light of Jesus to others. We shine for him. His light shines from us. So in other words, when people look at us, they should be able to see the character of Jesus in our lives. I wonder, do they? Or do they look at us and say, "Oh, they're awfully grumpy. They're always getting themselves in a tantrum. They're always arguing back. In fact, they're really cheeky." I hope that doesn't describe you. But if we give our lives to Jesus, then that should all change. And we should want to show others what it means to be a child of God, because we've asked Jesus into our lives to change them. And so we are becoming more like him. And like the baubles, we reflect. So if you haven't already put your tree up, and when you're putting on the lights and the decorations and you're putting on the baubles, think of what we've been talking about today. And if you've already put your tree up, as we have, just as you walk past it, take a little look. And if you have the lights on, see how the lights are reflecting off the beautiful shiny baubles. And it maybe remind you that that's what we are to be if we call ourselves followers of Jesus. We're going to sing your song before you go over to the hall, and I know you're practicing for the service in a couple of weeks' time, so you'll want to spend lots of time doing that. But we're going to sing a song, just "He Made the Stars to Shine." It reminds us that Jesus, whenever he comes into our lives, he does change us, because he's the one who died on the cross to forgive us our sins. Let's stand to sing "He Made the Stars to Shine." We're going to come with our prayers for others, and Sean is going to lead us in those.
Father, as we come before you with our prayers for others, we thank you that you know us all intimately and know our needs even before we ask. During this season of Advent, we ask that you would help us to focus our hearts and minds on your coming. We pray that we might approach worship this Christmas with all that we are, offering our lives afresh in faith and love to you. Sometimes when we see and hear what is going on in the world, it can make us despair, but instead, please help us remember you are sovereign and in control of all things. Therefore, as we face a world food crisis with 828 million people going to bed hungry, we ask that you would provide healthy and vitamin-rich food to those in greatest need. As we enter winter, we pray that you would help those working in our hospitals to cope with the ever-increasing demands laid on them. We ask that you would help them to use the limited resources available to them wisely in order to treat as many patients as possible. We think especially of A&E departments. We ask that they would not be overwhelmed and those that arrive get the care they need as quickly as possible. We also think of chaplains such as Reverend John Gilkinson in the City Hospital. Show them how best to support each patient they encounter and grant them the compassion and wisdom they need in every situation. We also bring those who are unwell at home before you. Please lay your healing hand upon them. Give strength to all those who are full-time carers, and we ask that they also have some time to rest. Father, we are all too aware of the financial pressures so many are facing, especially as we approach Christmas. Guide our politicians to work together to ensure that all cost of living support arrives as quickly as possible. We pray that no one goes without food or heat this winter. Lord, encourage us to be good neighbours and help those in need when we see an opportunity. We think also of our friends and colleagues who do not know you yet. Help them to see you in us through our conversations and how we live our lives, so that they too come to put their faith and trust in you. Finally, we think now of our own congregation and to the forthcoming Christmas services. We thank you that we have such dedicated leaders and pray that you would grant them the patience and energy needed as they prepare our children and young people for our Nativity service. We We also pray for the children taking part. Help them to not only remember their lines, but also understand the true meaning of Christmas. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
And we thank Shauna for recording that for us. Let's stand and sing again as we join in the hymn, Be Thou My Vision.
Be Thou my vision.
Come to God in prayer. Let's pray. Father, as we come to the Word of God, your Word to us, we pray that by your Spirit you will lead us into truth. You will open our minds to understand what you have to say to us, and then be able to apply it to our lives and to share it with others. We ask this for the sake and glory of Christ, both Saviour and Lord. Amen. I wonder, do you recognise that graph? You'll not be able to read the words unless you've got your opera glasses with you. Well, that is a graph showing inflation and how it has gone nearly through the roof there. 11.1 at the end of October, and it's still rising. Saying that, whenever we were married nearly 40 years ago, that it was that high and maybe higher. But we're not used to that. We're not used to the inflation as it is. And we have been told by politicians, by those who are economists, that really there are dark days ahead. And words like poverty, anxiety, fear, depression, misery, and hopelessness seems to surround all that is happening. Because we know that, and as Shauna was praying in our prayers for others, that there are those who are really, really struggling and need help. And as you watch the news programs, and sometimes I would turn on in the morning to get the Northern Ireland news on BBC, and maybe just before that comes on, around 7:30, that they will be telling you something that's been happening, or they'll be interviewing a politician or whatever. And these are the things that are now coming through day after day. Dark days ahead. And we do ask the question, you know, how long is this going to go on? And we are being told that it'll maybe go into 2024 or beyond, unless there is some breakthrough. A breakthrough, maybe that there will be peace in Ukraine, that Russia will step back from its aggression, that other countries who are rising up, showing their teeth and trying to take over other countries, maybe they'll reel back a bit, and that the world will maybe settle down. But it's not looking terribly good. And as I thought of that, I thought, well, actually, all of that is sin. What's happening in the world today is the result of sin. Where you have people who are selfish, you have people who are greedy, those who are aggressive, those who are cruel, those who have no thought for others. And it does, when you think about it, really say we are in darkness. One of the Christmas carols talks about this dark world of sin. And that's what it is. And we continue in that dark world of sin unless there is a breakthrough into this dark world. And that's why today I want to look at a passage. We're not going to be looking at the whole chapter, but we're going to read the whole chapter from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And Jeffrey has recorded that for us.
Therefore, since God in his mercy has given us this new way, we never give up. We reject all shameful deeds and underhanded methods. We don't try to trick anyone or distort the word of God. We tell the truth before God, and all who are honest know this. If the good news we preach is hidden behind a veil, it is hidden only from people who are perishing. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. You see, we don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we ourselves are your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let there be light in the darkness," has made this light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. We now have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. Through suffering, our bodies continue to share in the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be seen in our bodies. Yes, we live under constant danger of death because we serve Jesus, so that the life of Jesus will be evident in our dying bodies. So we live in the face of death, but this has resulted in eternal life for you. But we continue to preach because we have the same kind of faith the psalmist had when he said, I believed in God, so I spoke. We know that God, who raised the Lord Jesus, will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. All of this is for your benefit. And as God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. Amen.
We thank Jeffrey for recording that for us. I want today just briefly to look at the first six verses of that chapter that we read together. And if you have your Bible there, it would be very useful to have it open. I'm going to look at three aspects of darkness. As I say, the world around us seems so dark. And maybe that is why even more so today, there are people who, I better use the word carefully, plaster their houses with lights and all the rest to try and brighten up the darkness around them. And that's just physical darkness. But what about the spiritual darkness that's about us? How is that going to change? Well, first of all, we have to look at that darkness. And I have called it deliberate darkness. And if you look at the verses that we have before us, we have some of the reasons why there is this darkness. First of all, it's what I've called a variant message in verse 2. Because Paul is talking about some people who have come to the church in Corinth and they're peddling a message that is not the gospel. And because they're not preaching the gospel of Christ, the people remain in darkness because they do not understand what is happening in the world. They do not understand why they think the way they think. They do not appreciate how their actions have come into being. They do not fully understand what is happening to them and the state they find themselves in. In fact, they don't even know they're in a state of darkness. And these people coming and peddling a message that is not going to bring them out of darkness, is just keeping them in the dark. And I call that deliberate darkness. Because the message that these people bring does not bring hope. It does not bring freedom. It does not bring them release from their sin, which keeps them in darkness. It is indeed a variant message. But then linked to that, we have a veiled gospel. What do you mean? Well, if you think that if you put a veil over your face, you will not get a clear picture of what's happening out there. The whole thing is a bit fuzzy. You don't see it clearly. And again, this comes from a message that is being proclaimed. And over the years, I have seen it where even ministers who get up and they preach, but the message isn't clear. It's a bit fuzzy. And the reason it's a bit fuzzy is that they don't want to annoy anybody. They don't want to come out with the truth as it is. Because you see, the truth hurts. Have you ever been in a situation where you've been confronted? Maybe it's in work Or maybe it's in the home and someone comes out with a statement and you know it's true, but boy, does that hurt. Because they're touching a raw nerve, or they're pointing out a failure in your character, and it really hurts. We don't like to be told that we're wrong. We don't like to be told that we are doing it the wrong way. You can see it in children. Have you ever tried to explain to a young child how to do something whenever they're doing it the wrong way? And you say, and they really get uptight about it and can stamp the feet and all the rest of it. Or have, even within adults who have a mindset of it's my way or no way, and if you try to tell them actually that's not the best way to do it, well, you'll not be their friend much longer. But this is what's happening here, a veiled gospel in that, yes, we want to talk about a God of love and we want to talk about a God who wants to save us. But the message stops and not saying what you need to be saved from and why we need to be saved. Because the veiled gospel will say, well, you know, you're not too bad, but, you know, maybe you could change a bit. You know, and God wants us to change. But why do we need to change? Well, you see, the gospel says that each one of us is born in sin. And we can't get away from that. That is the truth. Because God knows the truth, because he is truth. And so he comes to us and he says, you are a sinner. And you need to be saved from your sin. But a gospel that doesn't tell people that is a veiled gospel. Because it's not giving the truth. A variant message, a veiled gospel. But where does it all have its origin? It comes from a vindictive God. With a small g, a vindictive God. It talks about, in verse 4, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. That's the source of evil. That is the source of sin. The devil himself, who is described here as the God of this age, he thinks he rules, and he acts as if he rules over all. He's deceiving himself, of course, because Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But he thinks that he is the one. And so he wants to try and convince people that he is the one to follow. He's the one who tries to get us to think that, yeah, doing all these things, it's great fun, even though it's wrong. He will try and get our young folk involved in things that are going to destroy their lives. And he's going to try to convince us, well, you know, it's a changing society, and we need to take on board what society's doing. But who says society's right? Well, you see, he's trying to push that agenda. He is a vindictive God. He does not want us to trust in the Lord Jesus. And he will do all in his power to keep us from it. When Paul talks about in verse 2 about the shameful ways and deception and distorting the word of God, that is a variant message. And those people who are taking it all in, and those who are bringing a message that's not the full gospel, means that people's minds are veiled. But those veiled minds that can't take in the gospel are heading to a lost eternity. And even if our gospel is veiled to those who are perishing. That's serious. That's dangerous. But it's all coming from a vindictive God. Second thing I want you to note from this passage is what I have described as dispersed darkness. And in verse 6, it says this: the same God who created light brings light into our hearts. Let's read the exact words. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. What is Paul saying here? Well, in many ways, this verse summarizes the message that Paul has been preaching. And he puts it in terms that the people who are listening will understand. He's chosen his words very carefully, and they actually will appeal to the interests of those who read or hear them. He begins by quoting God as saying, "Let light shine out of darkness." As I was preparing for this, I read, only light can disperse darkness. Only light can disperse darkness. And in this context, only the light of the gospel can penetrate the darkness of unbelief. For Paul, it actually was a real thing, wasn't it? His mind was darkened. And he was actually persecuting the church, but on the road to Damascus, he experiences Christ, and the light literally shines and blinds him. But the light of Christ comes to him, and he is a changed person. That light from heaven had shone around him, and the voice of the Lord had spoken to him. And that's when God shone the light into Paul's heart. And he said, "This is the light of the gospel that I want to share with you." He says in this verse that the God who brought light into being, and if you remember, going right back to Genesis 1, the first thing that God created was light. Light. And light is a theme throughout the whole Bible. It is common throughout. And it's always related to truth. It's related to knowledge. It's related to life itself. And so whenever Paul comes and says that the light shine out of darkness, the one who created the world and created light comes to recreate us. As he comes and he speaks into our lives and shows us his light, the truth, and brings truth. I read that every culture has a theme, and this is why Paul uses the words that he does. For example, the United States tends to use freedom to describe its culture. In Paul's era, the Hebrews valued light. Greeks valued knowledge as the culture of philosophy. The Roman culture prized glory, being the empire that conquered the known world. And in this statement, Paul uses all those ideas. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine into our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God. He says that this light from God is based on knowledge of God. And that only comes about whenever God reveals himself. And in this Advent season, as we think of the coming of the Lord Jesus, there is God coming to reveal himself to the world in human form. Read John chapter 1, and it talks about the light coming into the world. That's Jesus, to give us the knowledge of God. He came to let us see what God was like and to reveal to us our need of God. that knowledge and the glory of God, that is who he is in his person. He is perfect. He is holy. He is righteous. All those things that set him aside from us, we see in Jesus. And so we look and we see the glory of God in the face of Jesus. So here Paul incorporates all of these light, knowledge, and glory. And in a sense, this implies that Christ is the ultimate fulfillment of anything and everything we could ever want. He is the truth we all seek, even when we're blinded in our need. And so we find the light that we need to shine in the darkness. We find it in Jesus. Jesus is the answer to the darkness in our hearts and the darkness in this world. And while we're thinking about Christ coming into the world and we can get all caught up in all the frills and thrills, let's focus on what Christmas is all about. It's about Christ. It's more than the presents. It's more than the tree. It's more than the decorations. It's Christ. Because Christ is the answer to this dark world of sin. Deliberate darkness, dispersed darkness. And then we find what I have described as discarded darkness. We find this in verse 2. Paul is defending his message. He's defending himself against the accusation that people have been putting against him. Oh, you're only in it for the money. You're only in it for the prestige. You're only in it so that people will look up to you and say, wow, isn't he wonderful? And Paul says, no, we preach Christ and we do it in a particular way. We renounce secret and shameful ways. And he's getting at the false teachers who were coming, trying to deceive people, trying to make money out of it. Coming because they wanted their egos stroked. And Paul says, we don't do that. We renounce those shameful ways. We're not there with the gimmicks. We are there with the truth. It's a straightforward proclamation, he says. Verse 1, he says, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, that's what he was involved in, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Paul says, we're not coming here to make a packet by being itinerant preachers. We're not shaking the bucket in front of your face to get as much money. And we can think over history, recent history in our own land, where there are those who have come and all they seem to want is your money. Oh yes, they claim to be great preachers, but at the end of the day, they're out to line their pockets. All you do is look across the pond, as they call it, and you see those who are riding about in their private jets and all the rest. They seem to be making an absolute fortune out of being preachers of the gospel. But Paul says, that's not what we're about. He says, we are servants. We are servants of God. Verse 5 says, we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus as Lord and ourselves as servants for Christ's sake. And he says, over and above that, he says, we commend God through our lives. We discard the ways of darkness. We discard the deceitful ways, the shameful ways. We are out to preach the gospel straightforwardly, and we want others to see God in us. That will be a sermon in itself. So in the passage, that short passage we have looked at today, we have seen deliberate darkness. Do you recognize that? Do you see it in the world around? Do you see it in your own life? We've looked at dispersed darkness. And have you come to realize that the only way that the darkness of the sin around us that can be dealt with is only through Christ? He disperses the darkness, but he can only disperse the darkness if we allow him into the darkness. And then we've looked at discarded darkness. And I think it's something that the church and Christians need to really be careful about. How do the people look at us? Do they see that we are not engaged in the ways of darkness in our everyday life, in our business life? Do they see that we are actually living the way God has asked us to live? So this is something for you, and I don't like pointing the finger, but this is something for you and for me to think about. Until we come and we recognize that we live in a dark world of sin and that sin's within us, we'll not come to the Lord Jesus. We need his Spirit to come and to shine his light into our hearts so that that darkness can be dispersed. And then when it does, then our lives will show that we have discarded the darkness that can spoil our witness and can spoil the message of Christ to the world around us. So it's over to you before God, the one who loved you and sent Jesus into the world for you to die for your sin and to give you the wonderful opportunity of being his child. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you for this word that we have been looking at today. It's your word to us. And we pray that we will recognize the darkness. We will see and appreciate how that can be dealt with in Christ. And we pray that we will know him and allow him to come into our lives so that there will not be fear and anxiety about where we will end up when we leave this scene of time, but we will have the joy and the assurance that Christ disperses the darkness and brings us into the light of light, into the presence of God. And then, Lord, help us as we live for you, as your children, that people will recognize that we're all out for you and that the words that we speak will be truth and will be gospel. No gimmicks, but just truth. And help us to share that truth with others for the glory of Christ, through whom we pray. Amen. We conclude our service by singing a piece by Graham Kendrick. It's an old piece now. It was new and whenever I was started out in ministry. Shine, Jesus, shine. It's asking that the Lord will come and shine in the midst of the darkness and bring that light and life to people who need it. Let's stand to sing.
Light of the world, shine upon us, set us free.
Jesus Christ is indeed the light of the world, but he said of those who trust in him, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Let's go and do that this week. And we need God's grace to do it. So let's bless one another as we say, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.